In this lecture, we will see how we can use MOSFET as an amplifier and as a switch. Not only do we want to use MOSFET as an amplifier, but our amplifier needs to be linear. So how do we use MOSFET as a linear amplifier? But before we get into looking at how we use MOSFETs as a linear amplifier, let's look at a generic device which has a non-linear transfer function and see what are the problems of amplifying signals with a device which has a nonlinear transfer function. So we have a device with a nonlinear transfer function and we apply an input voltage as shown in the slide here. Of course, we know that the gain is the output voltage by the input voltage. We can see that the slope of the transfer function is highest in the region that is shaded by red. And therefore, the gain of the signal in the middle, the gain of the signal that is shaded by red, is going to be very high, while the gain of the signal that is shaded by green is going to be lower. Therefore, what we expect is that the output will be elongated at the center and compressed at the edges. So you can see the output here, and you can clearly see that the output is a non-linear amplification of the input. So if we get these highly distorted waves at the output when we give an input, how then do we use these non-linear devices to get linear amplification? So let us again consider this device which has a non-linear transfer function as shown in the graph. Let us take this small area of the transfer function, and you can see that in the shaded region we can assume that the transfer function is linear. Now at the center of this small portion of our curve we take a point Q, and we call this point the bias point. And about this bias point, you give a small signal. That is, you give a signal whose center value is the voltage is the bias voltage, and then you increase the voltage or decrease the voltage a little bit about that bias voltage. The output corresponding to this input is shown in the figure, and you can see that we have achieved a linear amplification. So you can achieve linear amplification by a nonlinear transfer function, by a device which has a nonlinear transfer function, by choosing a point in the transfer function and giving a very small signal to the input such that the transfer function in that interval where the signal is being applied is linear. The device can be used as an amplifier in the shaded region shown in the figure. If you use the device in the region beyond the shaded region, you will not get any amplification but just a constant value output. The two shaded regions at the edges are the places where we use the device as a switch. We'll look at how we can do that. So any nonlinear device can be used in two modes, the linear amplification mode and the switching mode. The switching mode is the mode where the output is constant for a range of inputs, which is at both ends of the transfer function. In between the switching mode, you can have linear amplification by choosing an appropriate bias point. So now that the idea of getting a linear amplification from a nonlinear transfer function is reasonably clear, let's just think about what the transfer characteristic of a MOSFET looks like. And then we'll look at how a MOSFET can be used as an amplifier or as a switch. And to do this, let's just consider this very simple MOSFET circuit where a resistance has been connected to the drain and the source has been grounded. This configuration of the MOSFET is called the common source configuration. In this configuration, the input voltage is the same as the gate source voltage of the MOSFET. As we already know, the gate source voltage is the voltage that determines the drain current that flows through the MOSFET. In this case, the gate source voltage is equal to the input voltage, and therefore the drain current is dependent on the input voltage. Therefore, the MOSFET in this mode acts like a transconductance amplifier, that is, an amplifier whose input is a voltage and output is a current. This transconductance amplifier is converted to a voltage amplifier, that is, an amplifier that takes a voltage as the input and gives a voltage as the output by the use of the drain resistance, which converts the drain current, the changes in the drain current, to the output voltage. Of course, it's quite straightforward to see that the output voltage is related to the drain current by the above equation. The question that we are interested in is, what is the relationship between the input voltage and the output voltage? And of course, this relationship is the voltage transfer characteristic of the circuit of the common source configuration. This is a characteristic that we have already seen. This is valid for all MOSFETs. This is the VDS ID characteristic of a MOSFET. Each of these curves is the relationship between the drain current and the drain source voltage for a particular gate source voltage. In addition to the relationship between the drain current and the drain source voltage imposed by the voltage characteristic of a MOSFET, by the ID VDS characteristic of a MOSFET, you have another relationship between VDS and ID, which is imposed by the resistance connected between VDD and the output voltage. And it is given here in the slide. We can manipulate the equation to get ID in this form. And the equation can be graphically represented as in this graph. Notice here, the axis again is the ID-VDS characteristic. So in the common source configuration, we have two relationships between ID and VDS. One relationship is imposed by the MOSFET because of its drain current, because of the relationship between the drain current and VDS of a MOSFET. Another relationship between the drain current and the drain source voltage is imposed by the resistance, and that is called the load line. Now we superimpose both of these relationships on each other as shown in this graph to get the operating point of the MOSFET. So let us now look at various points on this curve. Let's look at point A. Here, the input voltage is very low. It is below the threshold voltage, and therefore the MOSFET is in cutoff. Since the MOSFET is cut off, the drain current is zero. Because the drain current is zero, the output voltage is same as the power supply voltage, which is VDD. As we increase the input voltage and therefore the gate voltage, the drain current starts to increase. The increase in drain current results in a reduction of the output voltage. However, notice that the input voltage is still smaller than the output voltage. That is, VGS is smaller than VDS. And therefore VGD, that is the gate drain voltage, is negative, and therefore less than the threshold voltage. Therefore, point Q, which we are looking at in the curve right now, is a point which is in the saturation region of the MOSFET. As the input voltage keeps increasing, the drain current keeps increasing, and this results in the drain voltage or the output voltage being reduced. There will come a point when VGD, that is the input voltage minus the output voltage will be greater than the threshold voltage, and that is the point B. It is the boundary between the triode region and the saturation region. Point C is a point in the triode region. Here the input voltage is quite high, because of which the drain voltage is very high. The value of the drain voltage is high, and therefore the output voltage is very low, because most of the voltage from the power supply is dropped across the drain resistance. So let us now think about how a MOSFET possibly could operate as a switch. If we give a very small input to the MOSFET operates in the cutoff mode, that is the point A as shown in the graph, and we can assume that it is operating as a switch which is closed. The drain current is going to be zero in this case. If we now give a very high voltage to the gate, the output voltage is going to become very small, because the drain current is going to be very high. Therefore, it acts like an open switch across which there is a very small voltage drop, but a large current flows through it. Therefore, the MOSFET is operating like a switch. We can represent the characteristic of a MOSFET in a slightly different way. Instead of looking at points A, Q, B, and C on the load line in the IDS versus VD curve, what we can do is, we can plot a curve between the input voltage and the output voltage, which is also the plot between the gate voltage, which is the input, and the drain voltage, which is the output, and plot the same curve. So we have the same points X, A, Q, B, and C in this curve also. Now from this voltage transfer characteristic of the MOSFET in the common source configuration, let's see how the MOSFET operates like a switch. So when VI is very small, we have the output voltage very large. And this is the period where our transistor is in cutoff, and this is the switch off position. On the other hand, when the input voltage is very high, that is, the gate voltage is very high, the output voltage is very small, and we are in the switch on region of the switch. And therefore, the MOSFET starts to operate like a switch. How do we use the MOSFET as an amplifier? We have already seen that the secret of using devices with such non-linear transfer functions as amplifiers is to select a bias point. So we select the bias point Q here. Then we give a small voltage about the input corresponding to point Q. So the voltage corresponding to point Q is VIQ, and we give a small input with an average value of VIQ. This signal that we have given in the input is amplified at the output with an average value corresponding to the output of point Q, VOQ. Of course, we can calculate the voltage gain, which is essentially the differential of the output voltage with respect to the input voltage at VI is equal to VIQ. So let us now think about how we choose this bias point. So of course, we use the example of the bias point in the position as shown in the figure. We gave a small input here and obtained a corresponding output. Now if we shift the bias point rightwards, what is going to happen? Let us give an input at this particular bias point. Now you can see that the output is same for the positive cycle of the graph, but it is different for the negative cycle of the graph. And the reason why that happens is because the input is entering the triode region. It is leaving the saturation region and starting to encroach upon the triode region, where the gain is much smaller than what it was in the saturation region. Let us shift our bias point a little more towards the right. And what happens? You can see that the negative cycle of the curve is cut off more. And we say, in technical terms, we say that there is not enough leg room for this output. So the output cannot swing negative because the amplifier is reaching the triode region. So we must not choose a bias point which is too near the triode region. Similarly, let's now shift our bias point leftwards. And if we do that, we see that instead of the negative portion of the output being amplified less, we have the positive portion of the output being cut off. The reason being, the input, the gain of the MOSFET as we move closer to the cutoff region starts to reduce. If we move still closer to the cutoff region, we see that the gain still reduces. So what we have is that the positive cycle of the signal that we are giving is starting to be cut off, and we call this that there is not enough headroom for the output signal. Therefore, we see that we do not want our bias point to be very near the cutoff region or very near the triode region. We want our bias point to be in between the cutoff and the triode region, such that it gives enough space for the output signal to come without either entering the cutoff or entering the triode region. Now, of course, choosing the right bias point as seen in the previous slide is important. However, we need to remember that the entire transfer characteristic that we got in the previous slide comes by choosing an appropriate resistance. If you choose a different resistance, you will get a different transfer characteristic. So the two lines here on the ID VDS characteristic of the MOSFET are the load lines for two different resistors that you can have. So the line on the right corresponds to a very, very low drain resistance. And the problem with a very low drain resistance is that the output swing, the positive output swing of the amplifier is limited. On the other hand, the load line on the left is corresponding to a very high drain resistance. Now, in this case, the negative swing of the output is limited because if we increase the negative limit, the transistor goes into the triode region and no longer remains in the saturation region. Therefore, there is not enough leg room. So it is not enough just to choose the right bias point, but it also is important to choose a proper drain resistance. In the previous few slides, what we did was we derived the voltage characteristics of a MOSFET common source configuration amplifier by a graphical means. Let's just write a few analytical expressions for the voltage transfer characteristics. So the way we will do it is we will look at each of the three regions of the voltage transfer characteristic, the cutoff, the saturation and the triode, and write separate equations for this. So consider in the first instance the cutoff region segment XA. First, what is the condition for cutoff? It is that the input voltage needs to be less than the threshold voltage. This happens because the input voltage is same as the gate voltage. When the transistor is cut off, there is no drain current, and therefore the drop across the resistance RD is zero. Therefore, VO will be equal to VDD. That is the supply voltage. Let's think about the saturation region segment AB next. What are the conditions for the saturation to happen? One is that the input voltage needs to be greater than the threshold voltage. Also, The output voltage, which is same as the drain source voltage, needs to be greater than Vi minus Vt, which is the gate voltage minus the threshold voltage. Now, in the saturation region, the relationship between the drain current and the input is given by the equation on the screen. We also have the equation that is imposed by the drain resistance, Vo equal to VDD minus RD into ID. If we eliminate ID from the above two equations, we get the voltage characteristic in the saturation region segment as shown above. We can try to calculate what the voltage gain would be at different points in the saturation region. The voltage gain is given by the differential of the output voltage with respect to the input voltage. If you do the arithmetic, you will find that the voltage gain is given by this equation. You can see that the voltage gain is directly proportional to the drain resistance. It's directly proportional to the process transconductance parameter, and it's directly proportional to the aspect ratio. It is also proportional to the overdrive voltage, which is Vi minus Vt. Of course, in this case, we calculated the voltage gain at a particular bias point. You could get a useful expression for the gain, for the voltage gain, by manipulating the equations a little bit, and you would get minus 2 Vrd by Vov, where Vrd is the voltage drop across the drain resistance, and Vov is the overdrive voltage, which is essentially Vi minus Vt. Let's now consider the triode region segment. What is the condition for the MOSFET to be in triode? We need to have the input voltage greater than the threshold voltage. In addition, we need to have the output voltage less than the overdrive voltage, which is Vi minus Vt. The equation for the drain current in the triode region is given by the expression above. Also, we have the load relationship as given by in the expression on the slide. Now, eliminating the drain current from both these equations, we get the transfer characteristic in the triode region as shown in the slide. Now, we can make some simplifications to this transfer function if we assume that the output voltage is small. If the output voltage is small, we can approximately write the output as in the expression above, which can be further simplified to this expression. So this is the same expressions that were on the previous slide. Now, we already know that in the triode region, the resistance of the drain source between the drain and the source is given by this expression. We can substitute this value of RDS in the transfer function here and get a simplified equation. What we get is that Vo equal to VDD into RDS by RDS plus RT, which is the drain resistance, which essentially tells us that the MOSFET in the triode region behaves like a voltage controlled resistance, where the resistance is controlled by the gate voltage. And this is something we already know from the physical operation of a MOSFET. So the MOSFET acts like a voltage controlled resistance in the triode region. Just think about or summarize the entire lecture here. The first point that I would like to point out is that it is possible to get the appropriate transfer function for a MOSFET amplifier, both graphically and analytically, and we have done that in this slide. I would encourage you to understand the process of how we got the voltage transfer function, both graphically and analytically, so that you can apply it to other MOSFET configurations also. We also saw that a MOSFET can be used as a linear amplifier by setting an appropriate bias point and giving a signal around that bias point, a signal whose amplitude is small and it is around the bias point. Also, the MOSFET can be used as a switch by driving the MOSFET into cutoff when we want to switch the switch off, and driving the MOSFET into triode when we want the switch to be off. I hope you got an idea as to how a MOSFET can be used as an amplifier and a switch. I hope you understood how we can derive the voltage characteristic of a MOSFET, both graphically and analytically. We'll follow up on this lecture in the class.